Hi everybody, it's great to be back here again on Itamar. Today is Erev Chag Sukkot. Today we are about to celebrate the holiday of Sukkot after having a wonderful New Year, Rosh Hashanah, an amazing Yom Kippur. And now we are being wrapped, hugged by Hashem and entering tonight the beautiful Sukkah to fulfill the beautiful mitzvah of leaving your home and entering the Sukkah. There is just so much. I'm telling you, there. As a matter of fact, I give a lesson once a week on, online to some people that are interested, and I began this week in the beginning on Sunday. We were giving a lesson on the holiday of Sukkot, and have this beautiful. I love the Chalban, one of the great giants of Israel today, a great teacher, and he wrote some different books, and one of them I recommend very highly, is his book, a new book he just came out on Sukkot called Talalei Chaim. Amazing ideas, amazing things, and it's just so much to swallow. I was trying to give a lesson a little bit, but the book is hundreds of pages, whatever it is, it's a very big book. It just shows you again how much Torah is out there, how much beauty is out there on every one of our amazing holidays. So I thought of course, every time I want to give a lesson, I'll read a few good chapters, get inspired, and then see where Hashem takes me, and how do I personally relate to those amazing Torahs and try to come out with something very, very personal, and of course, for the enjoyment of many others, to bring them that same light, that same love, and let them continue from there. Because we all have to continue studying and delving as deep as we can in the insights of the Torah, and of course, for a purpose of making a big change on our hearts and our personalities, of being a different human being. It's a new year now, we got to take upon ourselves a new beginning, and to be different than we were last year, to improve ourselves in this short visit on earth. I'd like to begin this beautiful, I thought of, if you look in Zechariah. Now Zechariah is one of the prophets that we read on the holiday of Sukkot, and which really connects everything to the holiday of Sukkot, and we have to see how it's connected. But I want to focus on a couple of verses that I mentioned here, and then try to bring it in and connect it into the holiday of Sukkot. Zechariah 14, verse number 10, verse number 9. Before that, it talks about the war of end of days, the war of Gog and Magog, known as Armageddon in modern world. We call it the War of Gog and Magog in Hebrew, or the War of End of Days. And it says in verse, after this war, it says, verse 8, Vaya b'yom ahu, in that day, yitzu mayim chayim Yerushalayim. Water, like a spring, will come forth out of Jerusalem. Now, again, I'm not going into all the details, different commentaries on understanding this verse. What is the water will come out of Jerusalem? A spring of life, but of course it's referring to the Torah, the wisdom of the Torah in a higher plane, this is referring to, that the great sprouting of wisdom of God, the word of Hashem from Jerusalem, which is, as it says in Isaiah chapter 2, Ki mitzion teitzei Torah udvar Hashem Yerushalayim, from Zion the Torah will come out, and the word of God from Jerusalem. And it's referring, of course, to that time. And then it says, Vaya Hashem, in verse number 9, Vaya Hashem leMelech, and God will be king al kol haaretz, in the entire world. Bayom ahu yeh Hashem echad, God's name will be one. He will be one, and His name will be one at the end of days. This is, of course, everyone will be saying Shema Yisrael Hashem Elokeinu Hashem echad. Everyone will be unifying, understanding Hashem is one. And this is, of course, a sign of the elimination of all idol worship in the world, and everyone will become to understanding the oneness of God, that we can't, God forbid, replace God for anything else but Him. No intermediates, nothing else, but only one God in the universe, and the entire world will come to that recognition at the end of the days. So it's right here, black and white in Zechariah. But very interesting. We look in verse number 17. Sorry, 16. If we look at verse number 16, we see that this holiday is a holiday. The holiday of Sukkot mentioned at the end of days. So somehow the holiday of Sukkot is connected to the end of days. That's why we read it on Sukkot. And what does it say in verse number 16? V'haya kol hanotar mikol hagoyim. And those, the remnant of all the nations. What do you mean the remnant of the nations? The nations after this war of Armageddon. There are going to be, the righteous are going to survive. Habaim al Yerushalayim, which will come to Jerusalem. V'alu midei shana b'shana l'shtachavod l'melech Hashem tzvakot. And they will come to bow down to the King Hashem. Which, interesting, the nations of the world, Interesting, it says those who will be there at that time, when this is going to happen, this great event, are going to come to the temple, come to Jerusalem, to bow down in Jerusalem at the end of days. And those that will not come up, he's saying they will not have Hagashem. Gashem refers to bounty, which means coming up to Jerusalem is going to be a blessing for the nations. It's going to give them the life, give them the blessing of bounty. It's saying if the family of Egypt, now what does that refer to, the family of Egypt? I mean, the family of those, Egypt comes to the word in Hebrew, Mitzrayim, meaning tzar, narrow. Those who are narrow are, don't see, don't try to come to Hashem. You know, they will, it says over here, they will be stricken. God will strike those people, which means they will not be blessed. They won't come to Jerusalem. And referring, doesn't refer to Egypt per se, the country of Egypt, but it refers to all those who have that mindset, you know, that what the whole Egyptian mindset way back that, again, placed bondage over the people of Israel, and those who didn't want to see God were shutting God out. It's like narrow, like they made a narrow path of seeing Hashem. And it says they will not be blessed. They will have famine, which means the whole blessing of Hashem comes to those who recognize the oneness of Hashem, the King, and comes to Jerusalem to bow down to Hashem and to learn from God's people, as it says throughout, of course, the prophets. And then it goes on to say, it says over here, which did not come up to celebrate the holiday of Sukkot, which means the nations of the world have a very important mitzvah, a very important commandment that Hashem, at the end of days, wants those nations of the world to come up and celebrate the holiday of Sukkot. And if they're not coming, he's going to say, listen, you're in trouble for that. Zot tia chatat Mitzrayim, v'chatat kol ha-goyim asher lo yalu l'chog. And he's saying that will be a sin for those who do not come up to celebrate the holiday of Sukkot. And then look at verse 20, it's absolutely amazing. And it says, Bayomahu ye al mitzilot asus. And in those days, on the, you know, the bells they would wear or the nice ornaments they put on horses are going to say, Kodesh Lashem, are going to be written on them, Kodesh, holy to God, which we know was written on the high priest, the Kohen Gadol, would wear the tzitz. One of his garments, a special gold garment, it would say on it, Kodesh Lashem, holy to Hashem. And on these horses that have their decorations and bells, and our commentators, our rabbis explain this, referring to the fact they're going to turn this material, and they want to donate it to the temple and use it for vessels of the temple at the end of days. Unbelievable. What is this all about? This is a prophecy in Zechariah 14, talks about the war of end of days and those who, again, the whole world coming to understanding of the oneness of Hashem in the world and coming to celebrate the remnant that survives this very, very powerful war, this war of clarification at the end of days, will come up to bow in Jerusalem and come down to return to Hashem. And those who don't, of course, will be plagued, which means they will not have the bounty, they will not be blessed financially, they will be blessed in many ways spiritually. Again, I'm not here to define what kind of war in the end of days, but things the way things look now, you know, there are a lot of tension in the world, crazy things happening, but more than anything, the war at the end of days is a spiritual return to Hashem. It's a war of spirituality, of Hashem wanting to weed out those who do not want to accept the King of Hashem, to accept His presence, His oneness of the world, and those who do not follow Him, eventually, they will, it's self-destruction for themselves, you know. It's like anyone will go against them, they'll go against themselves, they'll bring a curse upon themselves by not understanding the oneness, the beauty of Hashem, connecting to Hashem and all His great glory. And He offers the entire world, not only the people of Israel, which is obviously lives in the land and has to build the land, they have their own things, of course, to do, but the world itself is so connected intrinsically somehow to this commandment of Sukkot, to do the mitzvah of Sukkah, which is, look, this is, I'm not saying this is what the prophet is saying right here, very clear, and we have to try to understand what this is all about. In order to understand a little bit, and of course, we're always limited in time, I'd like to focus on a great question that's brought down by many, many commentaries. The Rav Chalban, I showed you before, in the Talei Chaim, in the book I showed you, brings down this question, is what is the reason? We look at all the holidays, right? The holiday of Pesach, we know we celebrate our leaving of Egypt. And the holiday of Shavuot, we celebrate receiving the Torah. And then here we have the holiday of Succoth, which is, you know, which is very interesting. What was the reason we're celebrating it, right? What was the reason behind the holiday of Succoth? And, you know, one of course, the major reason, one of the known reasons, of course, is that God, it says in the Torah right out, that God placed us in the Sukkah. When we left Egypt, we were placed in the Sukkah. And therefore, it's sort of remembering that Sukkah of leaving Egypt. So the question, of course, right away we have to ask ourselves, so why don't we celebrate it in Pesach time when we left Egypt? Why are we celebrating it now in the fall, in the beginning of the fall, or in the fall time? What are we celebrating the holiday of Sukkot now if it's connected to leaving Egypt? And it's very interesting that our sources bring down, there are two major understandings in our Tanaim. Our Tanaim are great sages that understand the reason behind the holiday of Sukkot. Because the Torah itself doesn't, you know, hints of course, doesn't come right out and say what is the reason, what are these booths all about? We know, of course, we're talking about building a sukkah. We have very, very, very concrete commandment how to do it, how big it has to be. It has to be made out of, you know, of course, the roof of the sukkah has to be from plant material that does not receive uncleanliness. Very clear how do we do it, of course, and fulfill the mitzvah. It's very clear in our oral law and our oral traditions. But what's not 100% clear is what does it symbolize? You know. So there are two major opinions in our Mishnah, in our Talmud, in our Mishnah, going back before the Mishnah, even the Talmud, the Mishnah, I'm saying, by Rabbi Akiva and Rabbi Eliezer, two great giants. Rabbi Eliezer was a teacher of Rabbi Akiva, and Rabbi Eliezer said it represents the Ananei Kavod. Ananei Kavod referred to the clouds of glory. And Rabbi Akiva says it refers to, we're really celebrating the actual booths that we dwelled up in when we left Egypt. We have to, you know, it's pretty, you know, hot during the day and we were traveling, we rested. Obviously, we have to dwell in some kind of a structure. We were living in these Sukkot, and therefore the holiday is to actually remember those Sukkot that we left when we left Egypt. So the question is, you know, the Kaban brings down, is that there are so many miracles that took place when we left Egypt. We had the miracle of receiving man, and the water coming out of the rock, you know, Moshe Rabbeinu would draw forth the water out of the rock. And we had the miracle of our clothes wouldn't wear and tear, etc. So we had such amazing miracles that we could have made so many other holidays for, but the holiday that was chosen was the holiday of Sukkot, to celebrate, to live in these simple shacks, you know, these little things. And that, what kind of miracle was that? Wow, for this we're making an entire holiday. And that, of course, is a question in itself. If, according to the opinion of Rabbi Eliezer, it represents the clouds of glory, we understand very, very well that we're talking about a very, very spiritual concept of the clouds of glory hovering over us. It was something that, the divine presence, it was something very, very miraculous and very, very spiritual. Okay, we can understand we're celebrating that, but according to Rabbi Akiva's opinion, that we're talking about Sukkot, regular little booths, what could be the possible reason for making this into a great miracle? Making it, I mean, a great holiday out of this, a non-miracle, a very simple thing, with blowing in booths leaving Egypt. One of the great commentators of on the Torah, the Rashbam, the grandson of Rashi, he says something very beautiful, and he says that the Sukkot is a situation of us really remembering Egypt. Now, why remembering Egypt? Because remembering our leaving of Egypt, remembering what Hashem has done for us. We left Egypt, we had nothing. We were just had, you know, we were slaves and we had nothing, and Hashem then led us to take back, you know, some of the spoils of Egypt to try to pay us back a little bit. Reparations of what we, you know, all the work we've done. And besides that, you know, God was, of course, followed us throughout the desert and helped us and with man and food and sustenance, and such amazing miracles took place. And therefore, at the time of the holiday, when actually we know that the holiday of Sukkot comes out in the time of something called in Hebrew the Asif, the gathering. And therefore, when we're gathering up all our produce that we planted throughout the agricultural year in Israel, and it's now saying, wait a second, let's not forget who's behind all this amazing produce. Hashem has given it all. Look what he's done. Look where we've come from. We were born in Egypt, the womb of the Egyptian womb over there. That's where the nation of Israel came forth. And after coming out of all that and going through being led through the desert, we're not going to forget that that's all we had were these little shacks and little booths we had in the desert. That's all we had. And we have to be so grateful to Hashem now that we're in the land of Israel. And now that we have our own fields and we're raising our own spelt and our own barley and our own wheat and we're raising our own everything in the land. We have to be so happy and grateful to Hashem that we have vineyards and we have granaries and we're able to put things in our storage houses. We have to thank Hashem and be grateful to Hashem. And that's why the holiday of Sukkot is according to Rabbi Akiva, explains that these are the bulls, because we're remembering that this is what we go out of our houses and we're so rich now, we have all our food that we gather for the year. But we're leaving our house and living in this little shack to remember that Hashem, everything is you. And that's why the Sukkah is called the actual Tzilta Demnuta. It's called the shade of faith. It's like we're inside God's, you know, hugging us in faith of Hashem and relying totally on Hashem, because everything in this world is from Hashem and comes from Hashem. It's really the sea, the highest plane of understanding of what Hashem's gift is all about, and everything coming from Hashem. And that's really what Sukkot, you know, a deep meaning of understanding, Rabbi Akiva's understanding. The other explanation, Anei Kavod, the clouds of glory, of course, is another level of understanding, of course, which refers to the Hashem constantly, His presence is constantly upon us all the time. And sometimes we see it right out, and sometimes it's hidden. Now, in the desert, we saw it directly all the time because we received the man every day. So that was a way of realizing, wow, we see God's direct intervention. And that was the generation of the Midbar, of the desert, where there was miracle, constant miracles all the time. But the hardest thing is when that period is up and over, and then you're living in land, you're working, you're fighting battles, and you have to struggle with the world situation and all kinds of things going on. You're trying to build your land, and God's presence is there, of course, but in a different plane, it's hidden more. That's we have to realize that the source of everything is from those clouds of glory from Hashem, right? That Shefa, that beautiful divine abundance that gives, that takes apart, you know, comes down and materializes inside within everything we do in the land. So when you work in the land of Israel, Hashem is with us. He's in our hands that are planting the seeds and gathering the vineyards and gathering the grapes. Hashem is with us in every one of these things. And that's what we have to realize, that the combination of these two worlds, realize that everything we have comes from that spiritual plane, and that from that upper world, and Hashem is with us in everything we do, and we have to reveal Hashem in every one of those actions. So that sort of connects, Rabbi Lezer really connects with Rabbi Akiva, right? Rabbi Akiva spoke about the plane of a simple sukkah, but Rabbi Lezer's teacher spoke about the spiritual meaning, realizing we can't forget that Hashem is behind everything, and His energy is in everything, and everything we have comes from Him, and that's what's really giving life to us in the land of Israel, of course, because our whole goal is to come here to the land, and that's what really revives everything, brings it all back. With this understanding of the holiday of Sukkot, we can go back to what we opened up with, the whole concept of understanding the nations, and it's interesting. I thought of, in Hebrew, the word for Sukkot is Chag HaAsif, the gathering. And what does Zechariah open his words when he talks about Armageddon? He talks about the world at the end of days. And he talks about exactly that. He talks about Vine Yom Ba in chapter 14, verse 1. The day will come for God. And it says, V'chulak shalalich b'kirbech. Talks about the spoil being divided amongst you. Then it says, V'asafti et kol hagoyim. Gather all the nations. It's the holiday of gathering. So just like we gather all our fruits and everything and all our produce, God is gathering all the nations of the world. And don't forget the holiday of Sukkot. We are offering in the temple 70 bulls for the nations of the world. If the Talmud says if the nations of the world knew how great this is for them, they would come and build the temple again tomorrow. If they knew that when they destroyed the temple, they destroyed themselves because they were damaging themselves. The temple will bring a blessing to the entire world, and the holiday of Sukkot is for the nations of the world. And all Hashem wants to is for the nations of the world to repent, to return to Him, just like we just recently read on Yom Kippur about Nineveh and about Yonah ben Amittai, the prophet Yonah, who prophesied to Nineveh, that town, and said, in another 40 days you'll be turned over. And he ran away, he didn't want to prophesy because he saw what was going to happen eventually, that he's going to destroy the temple, going to come out of those people from Nineveh. God brought him back. They, you know, right now these are righteous people. You know, they have potential to be righteous. Prophesize and see if they repent, and they did repent. And that's really what Hashem wants from the entire world. The people of Israel are not a racist people, God forbid, and we're a chosen nation not to, again, to rule over the nations of the world. We're chosen for one purpose in this world, to be a light to the nations and to try to remind the nations that Hashem loves them. You know, we believe that God loves everyone equally, because they're all His creations. And Hashem wants His people, all His creations, to return to Him. He wants everyone to return to him. And at the end of days, which we're in a period right now, at the end of days, it's a wake-up call for the entire world. God is saying, wake up, nations of the world. Of course, Israel, we have to wake up. We all have to wake up to do here. But Hashem is yelling, wake up. And he wants the nations to return to him and to give away, throw away those false idols that are causing so much damage and murder in the world around these false idols, and return to the oneness of Hashem, which will bring bounty and blessing to the entire universe. And this is what Hashem really wants. And it all is centered around the holiday of Sukkot. This is the holiday where this energy awakens. That's why I read it now, because we're gathering and gathering bounty. Bounty is something that's very, very powerful, because it's Hashem. When you see a lot of bounty and abundance, it all comes from Hashem. And that really, so Hashem is within that bounty. And therefore, this has the power of gathering, the feeling of bounty in Jerusalem, and the spiritual energy is something that's going to cause the entire world to want to come. But unfortunately, there are those that are blind and keep trying to shut an eye. And unfortunately, it's a very, very serious circumstance which is described here. What will happen to those who go against God and follow the path of evil? Those who do go to righteousness and do good and want to do good in the world, it will bring bounty upon themselves and upon the entire world. And that's really the focus. The holiday of Sukkot represents the holiday. Every one of the Jewish holidays represents agriculture. It's a part of an agricultural experience. Just like Pesach is the beginning of the agricultural year, and then Shavuot already is the Chag HaKatziah, where you're cutting, first you have the Chag Aviv, which is Pesach. Katziah, when you're cutting the fruit, you're cutting the wheat, and then finally gathering it in. On Sukkot time, you have all that bounty in your granaries, and you have your wine press, your olive oil, all that's gathered together this time of year. And all this, the whole entire year is centered around agriculture in Israel. Agriculture, again, it connects what we're saying exactly, because it's all the love of the land of Israel. It's showing how you love your land, and how you're going to see you work hard and you sweat and you bring produce, and this is the blessing of Hashem upon the land. And it connects us to this wonderful, wonderful land that Hashem gave us. And that's why it's all centered around it. Because when you see something growing and sprouting, it's a sign of divine abundance, divine intervention, that He's created such a beautiful world. And let's not destroy it. Let's make this world grow in beauty and let the world prosper. And it all comes again from this one concept we spoke about, of the beautiful holiday of Sukkot. We're all in the Sukkah. We're all gathered together, being hugged by Hashem and saying, come, I want you all, come. 70 cows offer in the temple, right? 70 bulls for the nations. I want my entire world to come to me. Hashem is calling the entire world. Come and return. And don't miss the call. Don't miss the book. Have a wonderful Chag. Hopefully we'll get another lesson out. There's so many things to talk about. It's a wonderful holiday. I miss you all. This is a special time to visit Itamar. Those of you who have an opportunity, come and visit the beauty of Israel and see it on Itamar, how gorgeous. You see a beautiful land, and you're all invited. It's a holiday. Please take me up on it. You're welcome to come. Throw a phone call in and say, I want to come and visit. Come and visit. You'll be very, very welcome. So I want you to all have a wonderful holiday. And those who have any questions or anything, please contact me. I'm always there for you all. Chag Sameach and Besorot Tovot. Wonderful news and tidings for all of us. Let it be a full redemption very, very soon for the entire world. Chag Sameach.